I'd like to start and thank you all for coming. There was a very long line today, it took a little longer. We just heard an excellent ITC colloquium on molecular chemistry by Evelyn Murillo from Paris. We also heard yesterday a talk by Andrey Kravtsov, who is visiting us, about why galaxies are not very efficient factories for making stars, despite what we think about them. They could have been more efficient.
Yes.
And we will hear from Andrey a little later at this lunch. So we will start with our own graduate student, Stefan Portillo, that will talk about probabilistic cataloging in crowded fields. And then we'll move on to hear from our CFA colloquium speaker today, Garth Illingworth, visiting us from UC Santa Cruz. He will talk about his thoughts on flagship missions, JWST, and the implications for getting what's next. And as many of you know, Garth is heavily involved in JWST and future missions within NASA. So we look forward to that. Then we'll hear from Andrey Kravtsov, visiting from Chicago. We'll talk about the size-virial relation of galaxies. And finally, we'll hear from Dmitri Uzdensky, who is both at the IES and the University of Colorado, Boulder, and he will talk about relativistic turbulence with strong synchrotron and cooling. We'll start with Stefan.
Thank you, Avi. So I'm grateful to have this opportunity to talk to you today about my most recent work in probabilistic cataloging in crowded fields. I've been working on this project with Ben Lee, a senior at the college, Tansu Dailan, a G4 in physics, and of course my advisor, Douglas Finkbeiner. So to motivate why you might care about probabilistic cataloging, especially in crowded fields, I'd like to start off with the title of a paper that David Hogg and Dustin Lang wrote that states simply, telescopes don't make catalogs. The fundamental data product that you get from telescopes are sets of images, like this.
Goes, telescopes don't make catalogs, people make catalogs. And we make catalogs because a lot of the times it's easier to do science with a catalog rather than an image. You might take this nice image of a globular cluster, catalog all the stars, and make a color magnitude diagram to learn the distance, metallicity, and age of the cluster. And catalogs are so fundamental to astronomy that sometimes we forget that, you know, there are cases where we have to worry about this first step in going from an image to a catalog. And I'd like to show you that this is especially true in crowded fields. So let's take a 100 pixel by 100 pixel patch of that image of M2. And I'm showing you R band here specifically. So this is fairly crowded, but this seems like you could catalog this with existing software. So a team from the SDSS collaboration wanted to learn more about globular clusters, so they cataloged this field using the standard pipeline DAOphot. And so they identify a lot of stars, measure their colors. Things seem okay. But let's take a closer look at a 10 by 10 pixel patch of this image. So remember, the background here, the black and white, are the pixel values from the SDSS. And I've put the three point sources that the traditional cataloging software picks up along with their R-band magnitudes and associated errors. So one thing you worry about when your PSFs start to overlap is that the number of sources that are actually in the image might start to become ambiguous. You know, this part looks a bit funny, maybe I've been squinting at pixels too much, but maybe there's actually a third star in here that's blended with these two. And maybe down here, this looks a bit elongated. Maybe this star should actually be split into two. But maybe from the information that's present in the image, there isn't one right answer. Both possibilities are allowed. And so this leads to deblending ambiguities. And you can't capture this in a traditional catalog, because in a traditional catalog, you have to choose a list of sources to include. You can't say, maybe there's three, or maybe there's four or five. Another issue that you run into with a traditional catalog is you list independent error bars for each source. But when your sources start to get close to each other, the position and flux that you infer for one source is going to affect the position and flux that you infer for its neighbors. And with just individual error bars, you can't capture this covariance between sources. Things get even worse if you have deblending ambiguities, because now the positions and fluxes that you measure depend on which sources you actually choose to include in the catalog. Granted, this is a pretty crowded field, and these issues only pop up for crowded fields. But I contend that as we start to build better ground-based telescopes, this problem is only going to get worse, because better ground-based telescopes will still have the same angular resolution, thanks to the atmosphere, but they'll detect more sources, and the fields that they look out will be more crowded. So the better our telescopes get, the more relevant these issues will be. So the approach that we decided to investigate is probabilistic cataloging. And the basic idea is, instead of inferring one catalog from a set of data, you should actually infer an ensemble of catalogs. In doing so, you can actually capture deblending ambiguities, because nobody says that each catalog in the ensemble has to have the same number of sources. Furthermore, you can capture the covariance between different sources in different snapshots, in different samples from the ensemble. But what exactly does it mean to infer an ensemble of catalogs? Well, if you place the problem of cataloging in a Bayesian framework, there's a natural definition where you can think about the parameter space of all possible catalogs. That's a big parameter space. But you can still use the data to define a posterior distribution on this space. And sampling from that posterior will give you an ensemble of catalogs. And so this formulation also suggests how we should construct this ensemble. We want to explore this posterior space using some sort of Markov chain Monte Carlo. And so that's just what we did. But you know, we've done all this fancy statistics. How do we tell if our new pipeline is actually worth running or not? Let's return to that 10 by 10 pixel patch and the three sources that were identified by a traditional pipeline. Fortunately for us, people requested Hubble time to look at this very same cluster. Hubble has much better angular resolution, so for our purposes, whatever Hubble says is there is absolute truth. And this is what Hubble sees. And I've highlighted the brightest stars that Sloan might have a chance of seeing in bright green. So you can tell we've got some serious blending issues up here and down here as well. But maybe you can't blame the traditional catalog. It's not working off of very much information. There's only these pixels here. But still, we decided to try probabilistic cataloging and see what we get. So that looks a lot closer to the Hubble answer. And remember, this catalog is not using any of the Hubble information. It's only using the Sloan pixels. And remember that a probabilistic catalog doesn't give you one catalog. It gives you an ensemble, which I'll show you now. Each frame is a fair sample from this ensemble of catalogs. And you can see, instead of position error bars, you can see the sources jumping around to show you the uncertainty in position. And you see the magnitudes also changing to reflect the uncertainty in flux. And you can also see the covariance between different sources as they push each other around in the image. So this looks qualitatively better, but can we quantify the performance of these catalogs? If you take the Hubble catalog as truth, then you can calculate a completeness for both the traditional catalog and the probabilistic catalog. And it turns out that the probabilistic catalog in that 100 pixel patch that I showed you goes over a magnitude deeper. But you don't just care about completeness, you also care about the false discovery rate. And the probabilistic catalog does better, at least if you're brighter than 20th magnitude. And one thing to keep in mind is that 20th magnitude, the traditional catalog's completeness has already fallen below 40%, whereas our catalog still retains completeness above 80%. Our false discovery rate goes higher here because we actually start blending together faint sources, and the flux doesn't match the sources that are there, so that's a false discovery. And here we might be running into, finally, the fundamental limitations of the SDSS data in this case. So another way to look at that animation I showed you is to stack all of the frames. And so you don't see the source-source covariance like you do in the animation, but instead you see these identifiable clumps for each source that's inferred. And these are really suggestive of error contours for position. So we came up with a labeling procedure that allows you to turn these clumps into something that looks more like a traditional catalog, a list of sources, their positions, fluxes, and errors. So again, we're back to individual error bars for each source, but these error bars are now marginalized over what neighboring sources might be doing. And so you'll notice some of these have pretty large error bars because of that. In addition, a source doesn't have to appear in every catalog in the ensemble. For example, this source only appears in 41% of the ensemble. But the fact that you may or may not include it in your catalog is affecting the measurements that you're making of its neighbor. But we're properly marginalizing and taking account of those effects. So, in conclusion, crowded field photometry is going to be more relevant as we enter the LSST era. And the main idea of probabilistic cataloging is that you get an ensemble of catalogs, which captures degeneracies that occur in crowded fields, like deblending and source-source covariance. We can give you something that looks more like a traditional catalog and marginalizes over these errors. And this catalog performs better in a crowded field than a traditional pipeline. So, unfortunately, the main disadvantage is we burn a lot of CPU time generating this catalog. We're not in a state where we can redo SDSS or anything like that anytime soon. But we already see some ways forward to optimize the code, and it might be the case that probabilistic cataloging or something like it could be the basis of future photometry pipelines. I'll take any questions now. Yeah, so each catalog is a fair sample. So you can just get a set and consider each one fair. I had something else, but I forgot it.
When you describe the ensemble of catalogs as a posterior distribution, mm-hmm. When you write down base term, you have to have the prior on the catalog.
Yeah.
To use for a prior.
I'm glad you asked. So basically, I assume that the spatial distribution and the flux distribution are independent. I'm not expecting you to read all this necessarily. So I'm assuming independence of each of the sources, and I'm also assuming the sources follow approximately a power law. So it takes a very long time. This is a 100 by 100 pixel image, and it takes 250 CPU hours right now. So that's a lot of CPU. But I will remind you, so far we've just been getting the thing to work. We haven't been thinking about how to speed it up at all. So there's lots of gains to be made.
Does your error bars and the magnitude make sense?
So we've tried some comparisons, and we've been having issues doing the color correction between the HST band and the SDSS band. So I don't have anything further on that right now.
Then you compare with something like gay or float, which does no image deconvolution. So I wonder if you compare your probabilistic catalog with an algorithm that incorporates image deconvolution, do you see any gain in doing any realizations and then Markov chain stuff, etc.?
Right, and that would be an interesting comparison to make. Yeah, I think a lot of the gains are, like you said, from the fact we're doing deconvolution. I don't have a data set right now where we have a deconvolution-based catalog and a catalog that we can treat as truth like Hubble, but I'd like to do that comparison in the future.
Regarding the computation time, the benchmark should be whether it's more effort to do better observations, get better data, or do better analysis.
And I mean, I guess the main argument is it's really expensive to put things into space and maybe less expensive to buy more computers.
Is this the one that goes in here? A little hard to see. Okay. Okay. So the mic, thank you. Hey, you really need a mic in here. It's a big group. Good, thank you. And that's working. Good. What's the time? So is the mic working? Yes. Well, good afternoon, everybody, and thank you very much for the opportunity. Thanks, Avi and Anastasia, for setting this up. This is definitely different from my talk this afternoon, so it's in the sense of now for something completely different. I thought since we are coming up to another decadal survey, it was a good time to reflect a little, and this is only 10 minutes, so it's not a broad, balanced talk. I'm focused in on flagships. What, from my experience, our experience with big flagships in the last few decades, do we really need to do for a future flagship mission? And you'll recognize all these flagships, and each of these involved decades of work before they actually flew. And in the case of JWST, I'm going to concentrate on this a little bit, but so what I'd like to do is go through and give a little background about JWST and from NGST days, some lessons learned from that as to what is good to carry out in the early days or during the phase, the pre-development phases, to get support for these missions. I'll make some comments on one particular example as a step towards another mission to give you again a sense of the activities that are entailed in developing the concept to a point where it's accepted broadly as the next step, and the critical steps to actually realize that as well, all in 10 minutes. So happy to chat about this too at other times as well. This is going to be a long discussion over the next few years. So we go back to 1986, 87, when the first papers came out about a passively cooled large telescope in space and developed this concept. Riccardo Giacconi was the director of the institute where I was deputy director at the time. And Riccardo said to me and Pete Stockman, you guys need to get working on this. And we said, well, Hubble's not even launched. We're 4 years away, 3 years away from Hubble launch. Why should we be worrying about this? And he said, you need to start early. And he was right. And be ambitious. And I'll comment on that too later. So then we started some activities. Conference to bring people together to start thinking about this. Decadal survey, where we looked at this in the UV optical panel and came up with a recommendation for a 6 meter. Wasn't accepted that time round, but it gave us some groundwork and opportunity to think about this. Then we generally started talking about 8 meter class telescopes as the optimal size for a passively cooled one to follow on from Hubble. There was a study from money from headquarters to carry out studies with JPL on technologies needed. Very crucial step to make sure that there's confidence that some of the things that we were asking for could actually be realized, not then, but in the future in a technically reasonable way and a cost-reasonable way as well. There was a study put together then. There was actually a period in here where the budget went away because of a recession in 1992. And in an effort to get the program restarted, AURA set up a study chaired by Alan Dressler, the HST and Beyond study. They came up with a recommendation for a 4 meter or larger optimized for imaging and spectroscopy over 1.5 microns. This was good to have this, but the 4 meter worried a lot of us. Fortunately, Dan Golden at the AAS got up and said, 4 meter is such a modest thing. Why don't you go for something larger? And boy, were we ever grateful, because we know the sense of what happens with missions. You never get larger. Once you start, you're going to have pressure to decrease the size to de-scope. So starting out at 4 meter was politically, I think, a very unwise activity. So Dan's recommendation to go to 8 meter was very helpful. And he supported that through the remainder of his term into 2001 period. There was a very nice study carried out, which a volume here edited by Peter Stockman. Three studies of 6 to 8 meter concepts from different contracting groups from Goddard, Lockheed, and TRW. looking at what they thought could realize this vision of a large passively cooled telescope. Then Ed Weiler, who was very supportive of this activity, had been involved in the earlier activities in the 80s as well, signed the formulation authorization, formally putting ASA SMD in the path to this mission. But a key activity, of course, was the decadal survey recommendation, which came out of the panel that Steve Beckwith chaired, to do an 8-meter NGST. And then in 2001, development began, and the story goes from there. I'm not going to say a lot more about this because there's other activities as well, and going through a cancellation period, serious budget problems. There's a big story there, but the early phases are what I want to concentrate on because that's what gets us into the position of doing this when NASA agrees. So just JWST is looking in great shape at the moment, ready for moving towards launch in late 2018. It's a very challenging phase with the integration and test, and it's a remarkable mission. There's amazing technologies in here, and as we've started to think about the science we'll be doing too, thinking about the incredible capabilities that are coming up. Now let me jump over that page. It's just some links. So here are the comments I wanted to make about what you need to do if you're thinking about a flagship mission, one you want to start early, and you're going to think about it's going to take decades to do something like this. Start optimistically. The vision thing really counts. And as I said before, rescopes only go one way. People don't come up to you and tell you, well, that's a bit small. Why don't you go to something bigger and we'll give you the money to do it? It never works. They're always, how can you make this cheaper? Okay. We're going to lose science. Technologies, focus on the things that really will make and break the concept. You don't have a lot of money typically in the early days. Science is key, and I made this little comment here because often I hear and other people hear, well, this is really unique, we should be doing this. And this is not the case. There are a lot of unique things. What really counts is the science. So make sure the science is really strong in the mission. There's another aspect too, which is public appeal, which in many ways has almost comparable weight. Folks who are going to fund this, policymakers in the Washington area, really have to feel confident that they're going to get great things out of this and it's going to be loved by the public. And Hubble has set the bar really high on this one too. So an important aspect of this when we're spending this sort of funding. Persevere. There'll be severe political and technical challenges. And then, of course, absolutely crucial, the decadal survey has to support this at the top level, a mission of this scale. So let me just make a few thoughts about a potential flagship. This is only one of a number that people are considering at the moment. But again, the time scale, the activities have actually extended over some time. And there's an additional point I'd like to make in this too. So this is just a number of activities. Now going back to 2002 when there was a workshop again, AURA was very good at supporting this activity. And white papers, workshops, the typical sort of things that bring this to the attention, both of the community and the folks in NASA too, to start to give it some credibility. One aspect of this that I think personally is really important and interesting for these future programs is trying to get human exploration, human spaceflight folks involved in this. We're talking about building missions of scales that are incredibly hard to test on the ground. We've really reached the limit with JWST. If we go bigger, doing things in orbit is the place to do it. Robotically with astronauts, and this is actually a way of involving human spaceflight as well. So we talked about this many years ago. It's been talked about on and off ever since. It's a challenging political transition to make, but it's a good thing to keep in mind and to be continuing to discuss and to see when there's the optimal point to do that. Okay, so a couple more activities that continued this along. Another study, AURA initiated the High Definition Space Telescope. Very nice study, actually. They're very comprehensive. This was led by Sarah Seeger and Julianne Delcanton, and Mark Postman was involved. A bunch of good people on this. It was a very impressive activity. So that came out a couple of years ago. And then now there's the one of the several major studies that are being sponsored by Paul Hertz and the Astrophysics Division, looking to providing some input into the next decadal survey. And as I said, and I'll show you in the next slide or so, a really crucial step is this next survey. So here are sort of a summary thoughts on what it'll take to get a new flagship by the mid-2030s. If we pick a flagship for this decade, ooh, I'm running a little behind. Well, I'll take a minute or so just to go through this. We need to have a very strong science case. Technologies largely in hand, and a credible development path to the many technologies that won't be in hand yet. A few key science goals that excite policymakers, like first stars and first galaxies were the initial ones on JWST. It's expanded, but that helped define JWST in many people's mind. NASA SMD support, and I would really like to try to see us get involved, get human exploration involved. International partnerships, industry linkages. But absolutely crucially, it's got to be top-ranked. And if it isn't top-ranked in this decadal survey, I think for a significant fraction of the people in this room will not see this in the lifetime of their professional career. From now, or from the 2020 survey, if a flagship is chosen of the scale of Hubble, JWST, et cetera, like the great observatories we've done, Spitzer was a smaller mission, Chandra was a big one, then if we don't do this, you know, it's a 15 years away or so from the decadal survey, mid-30s. If we don't get it until the next one, mid-40s, that's a long time, folks. So this worries me that we need to be ready, and I'm very glad that Paul Hertz has put in the effort and funding to do some of these studies at this time. This was sort of amusing. This was seen by somebody in a subway in the Pentagon. Northrop obviously don't have very many missions that they can show publicly. So this rather sinister image of JWST was shown, which I always sort of enjoy looking at. But it actually tells us something here. I mean, when you do something of this complexity and you get the visibility with it, with the success of a mission like this, it gives us all the confidence and policymakers, folks in government, industry, and in the science community, that we can take that next step and do a comparably large mission. So I think at that point I'll stop here and take any questions. Thank you very much. Yes.
That's also very exciting. So how do we decide which band to use for the next
flagship? Right. I can weasel out and say that's the job of the decadal survey. But it's more than that. I mean, we do need to, amongst the community, assemble, do the precursor activity. I mean, with the gravitational waves, I mean, ELISA, we've done a lot of work on over the last 15 years or so. That has been around for a while. And it may be that a bigger contribution to ELISA is a way to do that, and do it collaboratively with the Europeans. What X-ray programs, where we might again be looking to the collaborations with the Europeans at a big scale. Things like UVOIR is a little tough because the technologies there are not things that anybody else on this planet has except us. So it's hard to do that in a way where they would not lead a mission of that scale. The far infrared explorer, a surveyor that's being discussed, again, it's not clear. I don't know, have enough insights into that. We'll see as that study goes underway and gives us much more detail. So there are different paths that can be followed and at different scales. I mean, when I say flagships, it's not as though we only do this. We can't. We need to do things at sort of explorer, probe scale. We need to have different opportunities there, and we have to do a number of things in the decadal survey.
Questions for Garth? Yes, Dan. There is a story in the Wall Street Journal that apparently the Trump administration is interested in refurbishing HST, setting up a manned mission in case JWST doesn't work, et cetera. I just wonder if you would think that to be a distraction and looking backward, or would something that be like a plausible, worthwhile thing to think about?
Yeah, you know, this plays into WFIRST too. And I would not like to see that impact WFIRST. WFIRST is an impressive mission, and I really think we need to have that move forward and as quickly as possible. You know, it's from the last decadal survey. It would be great to have that flying along with JWST, its wide field surveying capability, finding a lot of sources for JWST follow-up. On Hubble, it depends on the politics and where the interests arise. You know, seeing another instrument on Hubble would be great, but I would definitely not personally put that above doing WFIRST. But, you know, some of the dynamics here are interesting, and so I think we'll have to play that as it goes. I suspect that what the Wall Street Journal article said was completely impractical. You know, that was a much nearer time frame. We couldn't build an instrument and be ready to go, even if we had separate human spaceflight access to low Earth orbit. By now, it'll be 5 years minimum. And so it'll be a while, I think.
I was saying, there's a lot of alternative flat facts thrown about
that. Yes, exactly.
I have a sort of critical question. A few weeks back, we had a talk by Martin Eldis, who called it a crisis in astrophysics, and he was addressing, in particular, this point raised by Abby concerning a single-band flagship missions versus multi-band smaller missions. But then I made a small calculation with Michael Kurtz. The cost of James Webb is $8 billion. And if you count the number of SS members, it's 3,000. At an average cost of $150,000 per year, you would end up with $450 million. So this telescope, it's almost twice as much as the salary of all people in the U.S. astronomy for the time of its, for its lifetime, for 10 years. So is it really worth it?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, we should consider ourselves lucky that people in Congress, the administration, and the agencies, NASA, et cetera, have been willing to pony up this level of resources. They did it for Hubble, an even bigger number, $12 billion without the cost of any launches. And so, you know, we as a community are blessed by, one, our visibility and our ability to communicate with folks in policymakers, but also with the public generally. So we should build on that. We shouldn't give up at this point, for sure. Yes.
There was a development of the culture of theories that had no data to work with. And that is very dangerous.
Yes, exactly. But you know, I add one other comment. I think it really is vitally important that we don't do only flagships. We really need to do other missions, balance it across the field. And we can do that. Yep. Okay, even longer.
We need to move on. Let's thank
you. Yes, certainly. Thank you. You have a different one that you're using. Yeah, you're right there. And there's the microphone, too. How are you doing?
It's good to see you. Very interesting.
Yes, right. There's a big audience here. I didn't see you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for having me. So now for something, again, completely very different. I'm going to be talking about sizes of galaxies, which I consider to be the second most important basic property of galaxies after the stellar mass. And sizes are where it's well, well known. The sizes of galaxies correlate with stellar mass. So those two parameters correlate. You can actually see it in this background image, which shows postage stamps images of galaxies in the UCSS, with each postage stamp the same physical size. Different columns correspond to a fixed size of local, constant log luminosity step. And you can see that as you go up in luminosity, this is ranged in luminosity and color, but if you go up in luminosity, you can see that galaxies get bigger in these frames. You can also see that most of that increase occurs on the right part of the diagram. So there's a big increase here around from L star to large galaxies, but then if you look at dwarf galaxies, the increase is pretty mild. So you go down in luminosity, but the size does decrease, but by very little. So it's something you can see visually that the trend is not constant slope or constant power law. And if you look at the actual correlation, this is what you look at, what you see. This is a distribution of galaxies in SDSS from the recent catalog with improved photometry by Mariangela Bernardi and collaborators with morphological classification available. All galaxies are shown as this distribution, wherein medians of late-type galaxies, the galaxy classified as SCD and elliptical, are shown by blue and red lines. Now, this is well known. So it's known that the galaxies have nonlinear correlation from the early days of Sloan, and the fact that the late-type and early-type galaxies have different sizes at a fixed stellar mass or luminosity at around all star and dwarf galaxies. But this difference is actually what is maybe less well known, that this difference is artificial. So it's just an apparent difference, because we are usually plotting this in projection. So we're plotting projected half-light radius. Spheroidal systems, as any spheroidal projected systems, are more compact than they are in projection than they are in 3D. Whereas the disks are flat systems. So it doesn't matter how you look at them, the projection still, what we see in projection is still the true three-dimensional half-light radius. So if we make a correction for spheroidal galaxies, so essentially deproject the sizes, which is no, we know how to do. We know Sercik indexes in this catalog for each galaxy. We get this. So at a fixed stellar mass, the size of the galaxy doesn't, of late type and early type galaxies, is not really different. I found it surprising when I made this plot. I don't know how many people are surprised in this diagram. I usually think about ellipticals as being more compact than spirals, but the data apparently does not show this. They're more or less the same at a fixed stellar mass. But this is not the subject of my talk. The subject of my talk is that you see this very clear nonlinearity, this shallow slope of the size stellar mass relation at low luminosities and steepening at high luminosities. Now, what is it due to? Well, how do we understand this? If you look at where this transition occurs, it occurs roughly at L star. And we know also that stellar mass, if you look at the correlation of stellar mass of galaxies as a function of halo mass, it also transitions from a very steep relation to a shallow relation roughly at the same stellar mass. This is the relation between central stellar mass of the central galaxy sitting in the halo of a given mass, now probed by a variety of data at different stellar ranges, and something even consistent that's what you get when you match predictions of lambda CDM cosmology with observed stellar mass function of galaxies. So the, this relation between stellar mass and halo mass has this very well-developed kink around L star, and the question I'll ask is whether this kink is what's responsible for this relation. In other words, I'll ask the question of what is the actual relation between the size of the galaxy and the virial size of its halo rather than stellar mass. So the way we do it is, the way I'm going to do it is that I'm going to use the stellar mass-halo mass relation I just showed you, use the definition of the halo mass, which is related to virial radius in this way, and then compute from halo mass virial radius for a fixed stellar mass and construct the relation between half-mass radius of galaxies and the virial radius. So again, look at this. This is very nonlinear, clearly changing slope. If I follow these steps and replot these galaxies, I end up with a strikingly linear relation. So again, these are the same galaxies, ellipticals, late types, and this line is a linear. It's not a fit, it's just an eyeball fit. It's just a linear relation with normalization of about 0.02. What's striking also is that both late type galaxies and elliptical galaxies follow it. If I look at the scatter, so now this is something that I've seen in, a few years ago and published in a paper in 2013. So what you're hearing here is update using a complete sample of galaxies with very good photometry, improved SDSS photometry. So what I can do with a complete sample is to also look at scatter, not at the overall relation. So here's the scatter of these galaxies. So you see the same relation, the median relation that I showed you before, for elliptical and late-type galaxies, and then the dotted lines show the 68th percentile range around this median. It's pretty constant, and it's pretty small. What's interesting is that the scatter is very similar. It's a little bit smaller, but not by far, not by much, to the scatter that you expect from the spin parameters in a very simplified model where sizes of galaxies are set by specific angular momentum, which is assumed to be similar for baryons and dark matter. This is the kind of model that was developed from the 1980s and was put in the modern context by Momau and White, where in just a few steps you predict a linear correlation between the size of the galaxy and the virial radius with a scatter that can be quantified using simulations and is known to be about 0.25 decks. So this is what you expect. This is great dashed lines. The dotted lines is what you measure. Right. And very recently, people have looked at this also at higher redshifts, and they see that this linear relation persists at least to redshift 2 to 3, where candles still can show this. There are several recent papers that looked at this. And here they also see that it also works for late type and early type galaxies, and the normalization doesn't really evolve very much. You see the difference here between late type and early type because they're plotting projected radius. I think if you make the deprojection for early types, the relations will essentially coincide. Okay. So the message I want to consider is that when you look at these two galaxies, they look very different, but they have a commonality. Both elliptic and late types, the half-mass radius of stellar distribution is about 2% of the virial radius of their host halo. This is consistent with a simple expectation of the theoretical models, but it's actually surprising. The models are very simple. From what we see in simulations, the evolution of sizes of galaxies actually occurs in a very more complicated way than these models predict, and yet the result is consistent with a very simplified picture. I'm particularly puzzled, and I don't have a good answer for this, although I have some hand-wavy arguments of why this linear relation works for both late-type galaxies and spheroidal galaxies. Thank you. I think the Tully Fisher is surprisingly tight, but I don't have a very quantitative answer for that. So it's a good question.
The radius relation is beyond that, surprisingly.
Yeah. No, I don't have a good answer for that. I find all of this surprising. When I started looking at this, I had a full expectation that I'll find something different because I didn't expect this simple picture to work. But instead, I found that it does work, surprisingly.
And if you look at your simulations, do they reproduce?
Good question. So we look at individual simulating individual galaxies, and galaxies that do produce stellar systems with more or less correct morphology, they evolve in this way on this diagram, so more or less close to the relation, and end up somewhere close to it. I have not looked at a simulation that reproduced statistical sample. This is something that would be interesting to look at. But so far, yes, simulations show that galaxies evolve along this relation. But we see that feedback plays a huge role in setting this correct size. For example, if we simulate a galaxy where feedback is weak, we get galaxies with incorrect morphology, but it also doesn't follow this relation. So it's not, this simulation has dissipation, so it's not like baryons are just dissipating and settling into a nice disk preserving angular momentum. That's not enough. The feedback has to mediate the evolution of the galaxy in such a way that the angular momentum loss is prevented. And only then you start following this relation. Brightest cluster galaxies. So it's actually shown here, and the situation with them is not completely clear because if you use only light that is observed, this actually analysis was done by Alexei and his student. If you only use light that's observed around brightest cluster galaxies, this is shown by the solid circles, you get answers that essentially lies on the same relation. But if you extrapolate in intracluster light, which is almost non-separable from the BCG in terms of light profile, then they start to deviate from this relation up. But the VCGs are special things that form probably by mergers. We know that they're slow rotators, which is different from all the other spheroidal galaxies. So deviations here would probably not be that surprising. So by normal galaxies, I mean non-brightest cluster galaxies.
We need to move on. Let's thank you.
Oh, here we go. All right. Okay, so first, let me thank you, the organizers, for giving me this opportunity to talk about this work and for ITC hospitality. I will talk about something very different. My talk will be very theoretical. I'll talk about relativistic MHD turbulence with strong synchrotron and synchrotron self-Compton cooling. And the basic motivation for this comes from the fact that we do see numerous systems in high energy astrophysics that are shining. At the same time, they're optically thin, they're relativistic, they consist of relativistic plasmas, and they're turbulent. Right? Examples include things like the Crab pulse wind nebula and various outflows from black holes jet, radio lobes, and so forth. And the reason I included this picture here of a first principles particle and cell simulation of relativistic turbulence is to remind myself to announce that in my group at the University of Colorado Boulder, we are pursuing a program of studies of magnetic reconnection and turbulence with relativistic radiative plasmas, including effects of radiative cooling. However, and I will be talking about this more tomorrow at Avi Loeb's group meeting, but today I will not talk about any numerical results. Instead, I will just show you a very simple argument trying to understand the very basic thermodynamic properties of systems like this. And in fact, the argument is so simple that I actually wonder whether it has been made before. I would not be surprised if it has, but I couldn't find anything in the literature. So if you know that it's been done, please let me know. Okay, so what I'll be talking about is relativistic turbulence, MHD turbulence, driven, so it's basic physics, right? There'll be no simulations and no observations here. Driven on some large scale L, let's say I have a box with some plasma with density, electron density, and E driven with a spoon on some large scale continuously, and the plasma is optically thin and relativistically hot, or at least it will get to that state, relativistically hot. So what happens if you continuously drive turbulence? Of course, it gets hotter and hotter. You supply energy. The temperature rises until radiative cooling balances the turbulent dissipation, right? So let's try to make an estimate of what happens in this situation when these two rays balance. If you have magnetized plasma being turbulent, the heating rate, the energy dissipation rate per unit volume can be estimated simply as turbulent magnetic energy density, which is this, times or divided by the eddy turnover time at the large scale. So large scale, the driving scale is L, divided by some turbulent velocity. And if you're talking about relativistic turbulence, I'll replace this with the speed of light. Next, let's see what radiative cooling does. And let's just assume synchrotron cooling. That's given by this expression. It's proportional to the particle density, and then the standard expression for synchrotron cooling rate, where gamma squared bar is the average square of the Lorentz factor of radiating particles. And now let's just set these two things together. And what happens, the first thing you notice, and the most important thing, is that both of these rates are proportional to magnetic energy density. So that could be canceled out, and the speed of light cancels out, and what you get is a very simple relationship that the characteristic, let's say, particle energy, or let's call it temperature, squared is simply 1 over the optical depth, Thomson optical depth across the system, or rather across the driving scale. So this is the very simple relationship that just follows from these arguments straightforwardly, as you can see. Basically, the temperature of this, of such a plasma, relativistically hot plasma, goes as 1 over square root of tau. And it's important to note that it's independent of the magnetic field strength. It's independent of the driving rate. It's just this scaling. Also, as a side remark, I'll tell you that similar results, similar arguments can be made in the case of magnetic reconnection, which I will not talk about. Right. But now let's explore what are the implications of such a turbulent steady state with the temperature that we just derived for radiation, for radiative properties of such a plasma. And in particular, let's examine synchrotron self-Compton cooling. This is a scattering of inverse Compton scattering of synchrotron photons by the same electrons, by the same relativistic electrons, right? And the cooling rate per unit volume of synchrotron self-Compton is given by this expression. Compare it with synchrotron cooling rate. You see that it's very well known, of course, that they differ only by a factor having to do with the radiation, synchrotron radiation energy density divided by the magnetic energy density. That's this factor. Now, it turns out that, and that's very important, that if we now estimate the radiation energy density of synchrotron radiation in this case, right, it can be estimated in terms of this cooling rate, Q synchrotron, the cooling rate, times the system size divided by the speed of light. And if we are in a regime where cooling is balanced by heating, then we can replace this with the heating rate that we just wrote down on the previous page is proportional to magnetic energy density, and these things cancel. What we see is that the synchrotron radiation energy density is automatically comparable to magnetic energy density, and therefore the synchrotron self-Compton cooling power is automatically comparable to synchrotron power, ignoring various factors of order unity. And that's a situation that is maybe familiar in high-energy astrophysics, in particular in radio observations of AGN jets. We're setting up ourselves for a situation where we have so-called inverse Compton catastrophe, because one can repeat the same exercise for the next order, for the higher order inverse Compton components, asking what is the energy density of the synchrotron self-Compton component, right? And using these synchrotron self-Compton seed photons for the next generation of inverse Compton cooling, and we see that the same thing applies, and you have, again, comparable power. And what it means is that we actually, in a system like this, we automatically have a situation where we have several discrete radiation components that are separated in frequency or in photon energy by a factor of gamma squared, which, as we know, which, as we just derived, is just 1 over the optical depth. It's a large number in our analysis. And the emitted power is roughly comparable, slowly declining from one component to the next. Okay. And it's very convenient and simple to cast all of this in terms of two small parameters, two dimensionless parameters that govern the system. One is the familiar Thomson optical depth that I already introduced. And the other one is the magnetic field, the turbulent magnetic field in the system. To make it dimensionless, it's convenient to normalize it by the so-called critical quantum magnetic field of 4 times 10 to the 13 Gauss. That's the field at which the cyclotron energy is equal to the electron rust mass. And you'll see why it is convenient in a second. So with these parameters, we can, first of all, we can see where the peaks of this radiative components are, starting with synchrotron. So synchrotron, of course, goes as gamma squared times the classical cyclotron frequency times the Planck's constant. And it just turns out to be this normalized magnetic field B over the Thomson optical depth times the electron rest mass, right? Very simple. Then if you go to SSC, the synchrotron self-Compton, you multiply by another factor of gamma squared, which means multiplying by another factor of optical depth to minus first power. So you get optical depth to minus second power. And so this should be minus 2 here, and so on. And then you can continue with the higher order inverse Compton components, and you recursively notice that the photon energy of nth component is just given by this expression in terms of the optical depth to the power of n minus n plus 1, this normalized magnetic field and the electron rest mass. And then the sequence of components does not last forever. It truncates naturally. Very simply, at the at the energy such that the photon energy of that emitted inverse Compton radiation would be comparable with the electron energy, with the electron energy at the temperature, right? And then one obtains a formula for the number of expected components. As you can see, it's just basically ratio of the logarithms of these two parameters. Okay. And then finally, overall, we get to a picture that is very general, I think, for, you know, turbulent, relativistic, optically thin system, where in principle we may have some number of components. Here I drew three of them. N equals 0 is synchrotron, N equals 1 is synchrotrons of Compton. Then you may have another one. Quite often in real systems, you only have these two. For example, in blazar jets or in Crab Nebula, you only have these two components. But in principle, you could have more. And then they're equally separated by a factor of tau to minus first power. In frequency, they're slowly declining in power. One can actually estimate, again, through some simple algebra, roughly speaking, how the power declines. But it's the important thing is that the power emitted in each one of these components until you hit the Klein-Yeshina cutoff is comparable to each other in the sense that does not depend on tau and does not depend on B, the two really small parameters in the system. It's just a bunch of numerical coefficients. All right, so I guess I can stop here. Thank you very much for your attention. Sorry?
What about the Compton thick limit?
The Compton thick limit? When the optical thickness is greater than one? Mm-hmm. I haven't explored that, but I did.
You don't get the systematics in that
particular case. Right. So this is a very simple picture where I've ignored a bunch of things. For example, I ignored the fact that plasmas like this are likely to be non-thermal with broad power law distributions of energy instead of just one single characteristic photon energy. Another thing I didn't talk about is synchrotron self-absorption that may become actually important well before Compton thickness of order one becomes important. Right. There is also pair, right. But again, in many systems, including the Crab Nebula, for example, we are dealing with things that are really very dilute. The optical depth is very small. So what matters here is that there are a bunch of corrections and coefficients that here I ignored in the sense that I declare them of order unity, although in reality they may be quite large. But I think it is justifiable to ignore them from the point of view of these numbers being comparable to one as compared to the two numbers that I think are really quite small. These are the magnetic field strength and the optical depth. And for the astronomical systems I have in mind, these numbers can be 10 to minus 8, 10 to minus 6, and so forth. So these are the numbers that kind of control this picture.
So if you go to small tau up to depth, agree you have more and more peaks, but it is also true that the height of the high order peak becomes smaller and smaller?
The power.
Yeah, right.
Right. So if you have smaller tau, you have greater. Well, actually, no. It's no. Actually, it's the other way around. If you have smaller optical depth, you'll have fewer components because they're separated by larger. So they're separated by a factor of 1/tau. If optical and tau is small, right?
But the height also goes down, right?
The height will go down, right? But the point here is that if the optical depth is indeed small, 1/tau is a very large number. So just to give you an example, in the Crab Nebula, the optical depth may be, 10 to minus 8, right? So that would be 12. Gamma is 10 to the 6, and the 1/optical depth is 10 to minus 12 or something like this. So then you only have these two components. You would have synchrotron at 1 electron volt and SSC at 1 tera electron volt, and that's it.
So we'll make but high order peak harder to see.
Well, if there are only two, they are comparable, actually. Right. Right, right. Kleinische cutoff occurs between 1 and 2, basically, right? Yeah. But in principle, if you had high optical depth, the separation between these two peaks would be smaller. You would put more of them. And then actually, in the limit when the optical depth is still small but not as small, they just start overlapping. And then you have, then you actually have this proper picture of what happens, in, for example, in the Comptonizing Karonioff accreting black holes, like Sunyaev, Titarchuk, with, right. Oh, oh, wait.
It seems like nobody suggested that this was mentioned in the literature, so you can go ahead and publish it.
Okay, okay, right. So, oh, forever hold your peace, what was it? Forever hold your peace, or what did they say, right? Okay, thank you, thank you. Спасибо вам. Так, о, чуть не утащил микрофон.
Очень легко утащить. Вот это вот и это очень легко утащить. Кстати, где эта штука?
Какая штука?